So as I said there, module two or session two is looking at resilience. So this may be a word that you know well. It may be one you've not heard before. It may be one that suddenly you've started to notice a lot of people talking about more than previously was the case. For us as psychologists, the topic of resilience is one which we've been discussing for a long time. And as business psychologists at Zircon and B-Talent, as I spoke about last week, we look at it primarily from the perspective of helping people to be resilient at work. But that being said, the impact of resilience is far further reaching than just what we're doing at work. And this really has been demonstrated recently by how frequently this word is being used at the moment. So just a quick scan of the BBC website will show you a ton of articles which have the word resilience in the title because of the challenging times we're facing. And if you just do a Google search of news articles that have resilience in the title, again, there'll be dozens or hundreds even of articles talking about that. And therefore, we wanted to use our knowledge of psychology to dissect what this word resilience really means for all of us as individuals, what it means for you as well, and discuss what we can do to help us be more resilient during difficult periods such as this we're facing at the moment. And just before we move on, I just wanted to point your attention towards this quote on the screen, which was first said by a very famous psychiatrist called Carl Jung. Because I think this quote really perfectly outlines our current situation and the topic we're discussing today. And the topic we're discussing today. As we're all faced at the moment with a very different and a very difficult situation at present, even if it is one that is starting to feel somewhat normal now after, what, 3 or 4 weeks of it being like this. But it's up to us as individuals and as a collective to decide what this situation is going to mean for us, whether this is something we use as an excuse for things that we cannot do, or whether we take control of what we can control in order to succeed. So before we get into this word of resilience, I'd like to just take a quick detour beforehand to talk about another concept in psychology called emotional intelligence. Now, we're all probably familiar with the term of intelligence, or of IQ, means intelligence quotient. And we can all probably think of people describe someone with high IQ, such as being smart, knowledgeable, brainy, however you want to do it. The people that usually come to mind to us when we think of these people are the ones that come top of the class, they get the highest grades, and they usually have the answers to all the questions that are asked by teachers or by whoever else. I'm sure you've got the idea. However, it's also now recognised that there is another intelligence, emotional intelligence, that is important in terms of managing ourselves, managing our emotions, and managing our relationships with other people. And so people who have high emotional intelligence, or high EQ, as it's otherwise called, tend to be generally positive and upbeat people. They take responsibility for their actions and don't blame other people because they're self-aware and they're good in social situations and popular because they're considered nice to be around and people want to spend time with them. And there is actually more and more evidence showing that in many respects, this emotional intelligence, being able to manage ourselves and then manage our relationships, can be as important as IQ or cognitive or general intelligence in a lot of situations. And the good news is that the research is showing that emotional intelligence can be improved, it can be developed in us as individuals. And therefore, due to the close link with emotional intelligence, with resilience, the close link between these two ideas that we'll cover in just a second, we can look to improve our resilience. We can look to improve how we cope with these difficult situations that we face. So what we've got on this slide is another great quote, which I think really perfectly outlines what resilience is. And that's the ability to recover from or adjust easily to challenging events or change. So when we think about this definition, it becomes clear why the topic of resilience is so relevant currently, as we're all experiencing a really challenging event or really challenging events that come alongside it. and are all experiencing a change which is unprecedented and we were unprepared for. As a collective, as society, but also as individuals, we weren't prepared for this. And so what this quote means is that resilience is being able to bounce back. So let's think about the boomerang that we have a picture of here. Let's think of the boomerang is someone who goes through life experiencing challenges and experiencing adversity, but they maintain that ability to be able to bounce back. The boomerang will always return to that center spot. And on that journey of flying away and then returning back, they're likely to learn a lot about themselves. They're likely to face a lot of challenges on that journey. A boomerang is going to face wind, it's going to face trees, people, lakes, all sorts of challenges on that journey, just as we learn from the journeys that we face through challenging periods. And the good news is we can all use these challenging journeys that we go on to learn the techniques and the behaviours that we need to use to bounce back and to use these techniques to overcome these challenges that we face now and those that we're going to face again in the future, I'm sure, at some point. So, for example, with the current situation we're in, it's likely that you'll have some days where you feel great and some other days that are more difficult. I mean, I certainly do. But we can bounce back from the difficult days to make sure we have many more good days. And while there is somewhat of a genetic predisposition, and I know that's a technical word there, or technical two words there, genetic predisposition, and I'll cover those in just a second, there is still a lot we can do as individuals, which is within our control, to manage both the good and the bad days. And the key is to find the activities and to find the situations that will help us increase the levels of chemicals we have in our brain that help us to feel good, that make us feel good. And so just one instance of this is that there's now a ton of research to suggest that acts of kindness lead to an increase in well-being, which reduces anxiety and increases our own self-satisfaction. And I think this is especially relevant here, as it is important to cultivate and to spread a kindness and embed this into our society and into our communities at the moment. And so an example of a friend of mine comes to mind when I think of this, who he can no longer work because of the situation we're in. But the day that that happened, he set up a Facebook page to do people shopping for them and to deliver their shopping to them. And so he's someone who's undergone a massive change at the moment, a massive challenge at the moment. But he's coping with it really well because he's found a way that he can keep himself busy, but that he can also help other people and feel good because of that. So this is a big thing to do for him. But the idea of this is something that we can all do, even if it's just small acts of kindness, such as helping our parents, grandparents, neighbours, or whoever else. But I'm kind of getting off track there, already thinking about what we can do to improve our resilience and to make sure that we still feel good during these periods. But what I'd first like to do is just watch a short video outlining what resilience means to us. I've just realized, share my audio better than that. If I just rewind this, hopefully you'll be able to hear now.
Resilience is bouncing back every time something goes wrong. And when I was younger, I had I had dyslexia and I was really, really ill. I got a horrible virus. And I still went into school and did my SATs. And I ended up getting above average grades on all of my tests.
Resilience for me is being able to come back from bad or stressful situations. I was really injured at school recently, and my mum told me that it was probably best that I stayed at home for a few days. And I insisted that I was going to school anyway, and I went to school just to prove that I was stronger than that.
It's falling down and getting back up again. Not just the ability to come back from something that brought you down, but the ability to come back better and stronger, not just physically, but mentally.
For me, staying positive when a bad situation comes, thinking rationally about it, and then deciding on the best way to go about recovering from it. So really for me, the best thing is to stay positive.
How hard you can get hit and get back up again, rather than how hard you can hit. And, you know, being able to cope with any controversy life throws at you. And how you react in the face of adversity.
To be accepting of change, flexible to different situations, and seeing obstacles and barriers as something that you can learn from and develop yourself from.
It's about seeing problems and stressful situations as challenges and opportunities to learn and grow as a person. Juggling work, family, and relationships can be tricky. Any one of them presenting challenges, sometimes more than one at the same time. So keeping all the plates spinning can be fun.
So I think what that video has very nicely done, and thank you for everyone who contributed to that, is using people's own words spoken about resilience, and I hope it's really reiterating the message that I was trying to get across earlier on, is it really is, as that last TikTok showed, it really is about getting back up when we face challenges. And this, as I say, this challenge we're facing right now is one like one we've not seen before. But to dissect resilience from a psychological perspective, which is what I want to do now, resilience comes from three key or core sources or pillars. Number one here is social support. And this is from our relationships we have with friends and family and our community or teachers or colleagues, wherever it may be. And these make us stronger, these relationships, or at least they should when they're positive ones. And this is likely actually a reason why the current situation is so challenging, because largely our usual social support is not there in the same way. Or at least we have to make more of an effort to connect with that social support. The next pillar is about personal attributes. And this is an area we think about developing psychologically. So this looks at the extent to which we approach challenges with positivity, how much self-belief we have, and how likely we are to tackle challenging situations head on. And the third point is about biological makeup, or that phrase I used previously around genetic predispositions. And this is about our nervous system and actually how our body responds. So whether we jump when someone jumps out at us when we get scared, or if we get butterflies in our stomach when we're nervous about something, these are all underlying things that our body responds with. But we can use those first two points to manage the biological elements. For example, I still get nervous during challenging events. I still get butterflies in my stomach and clammy hands when I'm nervous. But I can use my social support at work and my friends and my family to ensure I have the support I need. And I can use my personal attributes around being confident and maintaining a positive outlook to manage these situations and ensure that these three elements are coming together to form the resilience that I need. And As we've said so far, resilience really is learning to bounce back, and was defined as the ability to recover from or adjust easily to challenging events or change. And that word learning here is so key, as resilience is something we can learn. And we learn to become resilient by developing habits that support our self-esteem and our self-confidence. Remember what we spoke about last week in terms of we as people are our behaviors and our habits. And so we can do this to, as I say, support our self-esteem and support our self-confidence. And these are actually two separate things, self-esteem and self-confidence. Self-esteem is to do with the extent to which you value yourself, to which you think you're okay and you have a sense of self-worth about yourself. So people with high self-esteem do not need to have external things to feel good about themselves, such as the newest trainers, for example. Whereas self-confidence is to do with having a trust in your ability to do something. So someone who is self-confident will seize opportunities and rise to challenges, They will deal with difficult situations and take responsibility if things go wrong. This doesn't mean to say that people with high self-esteem and high self-confidence do not suffer setbacks or have difficulties, but it's the way they perceive them. It's the way they learn from them in a different way. Think back to how we spoke about that boomerang just earlier on. So someone with high self-esteem and high self-confidence will not allow a challenging situation to result in them questioning their value that they have as a person. Whereas a person with lower self, a person with lower levels may do. But we use our resilience as a method for helping everyone to recognize the value that they bring and utilize this value in adjusting to the way that they approach challenges. So in a nutshell, though people with a good level of self-esteem and self-confidence tend to take more responsibility in their life and have a sense of being in control of their life, they do not blame others when things go wrong, but actually look at what they can do to make a situation different. This relates to all of us right now in how we view this challenge. Do we say things are out of our hands, whatever will be? Or do we take control of the things that we can take control of, such as how we use our time during the day? And make sure we do good things for others, thinking about what I've said earlier on. Because those of us, I think, that do this, that take control of those things we can take control of, will find the challenges that we face easier to overcome. That doesn't mean that by doing this, we're not going to find it at all challenging, but rather we can overcome these challenges we face, and we can therefore overcome future challenges that we face as well. And so what I'd like to do very quickly is thinking about this, just look at a really quick poll that I'd like you all to take part in. If all of you on your phone or on your laptop or whatever could just go to this website here of vvox.app that you see at the top of your screen there and enter this ID, this 9-digit number there, and answer this question. Of when you lose at something that you expect to win at, are you more motivated to have another go and try again? Or are you less motivated to try again and to quit? See a couple of people are managing to get on there now. So I'll just give a couple of moments for everyone to join. So we've got 6 people in now, 7. Just give 10 more seconds or so that you can put your answers in. And then we'll look at the group responses. So thank you for that. Let's just look at how everyone responded. So we've got 62.5% of people saying you're more motivated to have another go, whereas 37.5% saying you're less motivated to actually try again. And but both of these are fair responses, and I definitely have both of these responses depending on the situation that I'm facing, depending on the thing that I've lost at, and how frustrated I am with that. The reason I've asked this is because this is actually something we can control. We can control whether we motivate ourselves to have another go or whether we just decide we don't want to. And so we can decide whether we motivate ourselves to practice more or whether we don't bother. These are behaviors that are really in our hands. And by making the decision to do so, to invest more and motivate ourselves, we're able to boost our resilience to overcome the challenges that we face. And when we view a loss as something to learn from and to motivate ourselves to try harder in the future, we can really invest in improving, in seeking to overcome that challenge when we face that again, or when we face similar challenges. But of course, that's a difficult thing to do. And so last week, we spoke about we as people, how we are the behaviors we show most often. And we've covered this already briefly today, during the most challenging situations, we are actually likely to show behaviors that we wouldn't normally, both due to conscious decisions that we made and unconscious influences. So a conscious decision might be to help a neighbour, or an unconscious decision might be to keep our distance from other people. And so we've all seen likely a selection of both good and bad behaviours on the news, on social media, and when we've been allowed out to go to the shops or whatever else. And our job as psychologists is to seek to understand what is causing this behaviour so that we can encourage more of the good and less of the bad. Remember what we spoke about last week in terms of psychology, thinking about going from describing and explaining behaviour to changing it in a positive way. So the good behaviour we're seeing here, such as this list, is likely to be demonstrated most often by those who have strong resilience, because they are seeing this as a situation not that requires panic, but one that requires positivity, for instance. However, it's not that simple that resilience will cause these behaviours. It's also that these behaviours will improve our resilience a lot of the time. Remember what we mentioned earlier about habits to improve our self-esteem and resilience. Think about how regularly helping others during this period can boost your self-esteem and boost your resilience as well. And so these behaviours and habits you learn during this period will help you far beyond this, both in the everyday and the future challenges that we face. And so what really has been fantastic actually during this period is we are seeing such positive behaviours at both the individual and the collective level. We're seeing people go out of their way to help the most vulnerable in our society, doing shopping and collecting medicine. But we're also seeing companies and countries do things that actually we would never have thought of possible before, such as the creation of the Nightingale hospitals across the UK, which have been built or created in weeks, when usually it would take years to build a new hospital or to kit out a new hospital. And so most of these behaviours are quite self-explanatory, but one I really want to point out explicitly is the final one on this list, about being more mindful in our behaviours. And what this means is that we are more aware of the things we are doing and reflect on the why. Usually when we're in a routine, we just do things because we do them, as we do in our everyday lives. But this massive change has required us to think about why we're taking on these behaviours. And so an example of a more mindful behaviour is being more aware of the impacts we're having on other people when we're crossing paths in shops and therefore keeping. We're also seeing examples of less good behaviours though, especially during the start of this panic that we saw, but some do continue. The obvious ones around being arguing in supermarkets and panic buying, but also going out to see friends and relaxing our attitudes towards the isolation, because it's actually really difficult. And something especially coming to prominence right now on social media is around judgmental behaviours we're seeing of one another, with people being quick to see something and to call that out as wrong to do. But remember what we said last week about we cannot make a judgment on a person because of a single behavior we see. It's not fair to make a conclusion based on one instance. Remember, people are more than just a single behavior we see from that person. And this is a slide I've put up, but I want to go over it really quickly actually, because we are short of time. But this is a concept I want to introduce in psychology called the fundamental attribution error. And this is when we don't take into account the context of why someone is making a decision. And remember what I said earlier, that this context that we're currently in is so different to any context we've seen before, any situation that we've seen before. And so we're seeing really different behaviours, both good and bad. And what we want to do is make sure that we encourage the good behaviours, but consider why these bad behaviours are still happening and what we can do to encourage people to change them. So encourage people not to have to panic buy all the time, but also recognising why that is occurring, why people may be nervous. And so the final things I just want to touch on in the last couple of minutes are the characteristics of resilient people. And as I say, these are all things that we can actually learn, that we can all, especially during challenging periods, that we can all develop. So just to highlight these briefly, one is about being self-aware. So knowing what we're good at and what we're struggling with, so that we can be honest with people about what we're struggling with, and we can seek support from other people. Remember what we said about the social support being a key element of resilience. So I can go to my family, my friends, my colleagues, and say when I'm struggling, so that I can overcome that. Another is being about positive with the changes we're facing in this massively changing world that we're in, having a can-do mindset and seeking to overcome these problems and not being overwhelmed by the problems we face. And therefore maintaining a positive outlook that supports us in viewing these situations from different perspectives and looking for that silver lining or what we can learn. Remember all those good behaviors we're seeing, those really are a silver lining, a good thing that's come out from this negative situation. And also being pragmatic. So recognizing that not everything can be perfect right now, but seeking to really maximize the good and manage the bad, seeing it with a glass half full mentality. And so I just want to leave you now with some final coping mechanisms, some things that we can all do during this period and during other situations to make sure that we cope. This term coping mechanism is a technical term in psychology, which refers to the actions or the behaviors that we engage in when we need to demonstrate resilience, or the things that we need to do to build the armor around us to bounce back from the disappointments we face. So as I say, this is reaching out to other people for support. This is moving to action, and what that means is doing the things that build our resilience, whether that be exercising or reading or having a structure, whatever that may be. Having goals that we can achieve during this period, but that challenge us as well. Adapting and looking after ourselves and the people around us while not overly stressing, remaining relaxed and considering the situation. And so I'll leave us on that point, because we are approaching half past and we're about to enter the next lesson with my colleagues Caitlin and Kate. But I just want to leave you with, next time we'll be looking at communicating and maintaining our relationships. As always, if you have any questions, please do reach out to us. And if you would like to join the next lesson, then all you have to do is leave this call right now and you'll be able to join the next call in just a minute. And thank you all for joining again.